being taught from childhood to think of war as a glorious exercise, death in battle as the noblest fate for man. That there is a nation which has abandoned all its liberties in order to augment its collective strength. There is a nation which, with all its strength and virtue, is in the grip of a group of ruthless men preaching a gospel of intolerance and racial pride, unrestrained by law, by parliament, or by public opinion. In that country, all pacifist speeches, all morbid war books are forbidden or suppressed, and their authors rigorously imprisoned. From their new table of commandments, they have omitted, "Thou shalt not kill." It is but 20 years since these neighbors of ours fought almost the whole world and almost defeated them. Now they are rearmed with the utmost speed, and ready to their hands is this new and manageable weapon of the air, against which our navy is no defense, and before which the women, children, the weak and frail, the pacifist and the jingo, the warrior and the civilian, the front line trenches and the cottage home, all lie in equal and impartial perilous. Nay, worse still, for with the new weapon has come a new method, or rather has come back the most brutish method of ancient barbarism, namely the possibility of compelling the submission of races by terrorizing